not accept the affirmative action on this right. We have so many educated people. Why we have to have, because we are Ethiopians, we have to choose to get that body. We can wait. We have so many educated people in Israel, especially the second generation now. Can we? We don't know. We don't need that. When I said that, some of the people say because of the things that I say, our background.
Right.
So it's okay to give that affirmative action to give us sports for Ethiopia. I personally, I'll tell you why. I'm not an ambassador because I'm Ethiopian. I'm an ambassador because I'm Belaynish. I can do it the best way I can. For the first time, I brought the Israeli foreign prime minister to visit Ethiopia. For the first time in the history, you know, people are talking to Queen of Sheba and King Solomon.
Right.
King Solomon didn't go to Ethiopia. Queen Sheba came to Jerusalem. This time, Bibi went to Ethiopia. He went to market with his Queen of Sheba, so that's fine. But, you know, we can do it. That's why we can do it. Yes, we can. Exactly. That's what we need to do. The only thing is to promote and to educate. When we start to work on one thing, we are successful.
You know, Ambassador, many of us, as the African American community in this country, don't appreciate the fact that our particular experience here is not necessarily the experience of other people of African descent in other places around the world.
Yeah.
And so for us, we had Jim Crow. Well, you never faced Jim Crow. You may know what Jim Crow is from living in America the years you did. You may understand how we face discrimination here, but those elements of our existence and experiences here were not necessarily transferable to your community in Israel or to your community in Ethiopia because you come out of an African country itself. And so I think that African Americans don't necessarily have a worldview that helps them to understand that what we have experienced here is not the same thing that other people of African descent have experienced in other places in the world. Many of our leading artists left America and went to France. They went to Great Britain. They went to other places where discrimination was not what it was here. And so it's in hearing what you are saying, it's based upon your life experiences so that we didn't, what we experienced was more discrimination that was more institutionalized, okay? And so therefore, our experience simply was not your experience of the Ethiopian community in Israel, because the individuals that were discriminatory towards Ethiopians, it wasn't from the government. Here, discrimination was promulgated by the government and then sent into the other elements of the society. And so it was exactly the reverse as it was in other places. And that's an issue, I think, that particularly our people that have never traveled outside of the United States, traveled to Africa, traveled to Europe, seen African people thriving in other settings in the world, so that their world experiences is beyond the United States of America. And they don't understand why other people from Africa want to get here. They don't see it because they see the discrimination that their grandparents or parents or they themselves went through. And they don't understand that people from Nigeria, Sudan, people from Ghana, people from Cameroon, South Africa, and everywhere on the continent, or Brazil, would give their eye teeth to be here and to be in this country, because they see it truly as a place of opportunity where African Americans don't necessarily see America in that same light. So talk to us a little bit about how do Africans see America as opposed to how African Americans see America.
You know, now I have been to Ethiopia 5 years. Everybody's dreaming to be in America. Tell you the truth. Nobody's reading the history. Nobody's just wanted to go back and to search, to research, and to know what was here. That's the land of opportunity, that's how they call it, to come to America, a big America. You know how many people are feeling this duty to come to America and get that to that lottery to come to America? America is a land of opportunity. I cannot say that it's not. It is. But the thing in Africa is there are so many young people without work. They finish college and they don't have work. That is why just it's what driving them to go to another country. America is a dream, but not only America. Also, they are going to Sweden or any other Western countries to get a better life. What I'm saying is, if they develop Africa, Africa is the future of the world.
Amen.
Tell you the truth. It's now, without developing Africa, you know, in Europe, they don't have anything anymore. They did what they did. The slave trade, the colonialism, whatever. But they don't have anything now. Africa is, everybody's opening their eyes to go and to invest in Africa. Mm-hmm. Without Africa, the world is going to be a different world. I'm telling you.
You couldn't have a cell phone without Congo because it has all of the elements that are in your cell phone.
Yes.
You pick it up in Congo.
Curiosity.
Nice and loud, Donnie, please.
Yes, out of curiosity, Ambassador, the Chinese have instituted, implemented this plan called the Road and the Belt in terms of building a lot of infrastructure in African society, in African countries. My question is, in Ethiopia itself, how much development is China doing in Ethiopia and how is it impacting that society? And what is the relationship between China and Israel?
Ooh, that was a President Obama question.
China and Israel, we have a very good relationship. China is kind of, I don't know if I can call it colonialism, but China is in Africa, except Rwanda.
Except Rwanda.
Rwanda, they told them, if you come to Africa, bring the experts and the money. The employees has to be Rwandan only. Mm. That's why you don't see many Chinese in Rwanda. In Ethiopia, there's a big. They're coming with a lot of money. You know, a lot of money. Mm-hmm. There are problems. There are problems, the roads that the Chinese are building, it's not very successful. Now they start to understand. But still China is coming with a lot of money in Africa. They are in Africa, almost everywhere. They are building. They have a lot of money. I don't know where it comes from. Israel, we have, a good relationship. They are buying a lot of technology from Israel. Some of the people start to study the Tanakh, the Chinese.
Oh, really?
Because they do not understand why the Jewish people are very successful, winning the Nobel Prize. Why the Jews are winning a lot of Nobel Prize. If you compare it, the Chinese to reach, I mean to be, to reach the Israeli level, they have to have more than 2 million Chinese has to win the Nobel Prize. I mean, comparing the number of Jews in the world and the number of the Chinese. So they started to study Tanakh. Maybe the Tanakh is something opening their mind.
Chinese are beginning to study Torah. So that in studying Tanakh and Torah, they can learn why, with the Jewish population in the world, they are getting a disproportionate number of the, Nobel Prizes in different areas, physics and economics and so forth. And the Chinese have over 1 billion people. And we're saying, wait a minute, it's only this many of them, it's this many of us, how are they getting all of these Nobel Prizes? It must be in what they're studying. Keep your kids in the Tanakh.
Amen.